Today we are going to cover introduction of motivation and theories of motivation. These are certain texts or reference books which may be referred by the students for the chapter. Stephen Robbins and Moorhead and Griffin. These are two books which would cover the same text which I am covering today. First, let us start off with the definition of term motivation. As said by Stephen Robbins, it is the processes that account for an individual's intensity, direction, and persistence of effort towards attaining a goal. There are three key elements in this definition if you look at. The first one is intensity, which means how hard a person tries. That is, if there is high intensity, it would lead to high performance. Direction, that is, efforts should be channelized to achieve the goals. And persistence is how long a person continues his efforts even though faced with failures. So this definition very well defines the term motivation, and we can say that it is the set of force that led people to behave in a particular way. So if we talk about students who stay up all the night to ensure that their examination papers would be best, and the salesperson who work on Saturdays and Sundays to get ahead in their targets, the doctors who make a follow-up calls to patients to check on their conditions, these are all examples of the motivated set of people. So, motivation in this slide, we can say there is an equation, that is, it shows performance is equal to ability plus motivation plus environment. What does that mean? To have high performance, it is important that these three components should be there, and any absence or deficiency of either of them would lead into bad performance. So, motivation is that people are trying hard to do something, they must do their job well. Ability is they must be able to do their job effectively. And the last one, environment, which means they must have the resources, equipment, and all information to perform that particular job. Now with this, it is very clear the term motivation is an inner drive which pushes performance from the employees, which would yield them the desired results. We'll start off with the content theories of motivation today. These theories by the name content theories, we mean that they are deficiency based theories. That means motivation is an outcome of need or wants or desires of people. So if an employee who wants a reward in the form of financial reward, then he would strive hard to work and to achieve that reward. So then he would get motivated. So these content theories actually emphasize on the need of the employees, which motivates them. These are these five sets of theories, which are very renowned theories, which we would categorize under content theories. The first and the oldest one is Maslow's need hierarchy theory. Now this theory, it was developed in 1940s, and as the name is there, it is developed by Abraham Maslow. This theory believes we each have a hierarchy of needs that ranges from lower to higher. As lower needs are fulfilled, there is a tendency for other higher need to emerge, and behavior is determined by the strongest need. This was an assumption by Abraham Maslow. So he gave a set of needs, five sets of needs, to define this theory. The essence of theory which Maslow strongly believed in was that people are wanting beings and their needs influence behavior. Only unsatisfied needs influence behavior, satisfied needs do not act as motivators. So he believed that if a person is satisfied in one of the needs, he would not be motivated to fulfill it again, to do that particular task which is going to yield him the same need. So only unsatisfied needs act as motivators. Since needs are many, they are arranged in hierarchy from basic to complex. Now here we are talking of the Maslow's pyramid, which he has given, wherein he has given a hierarchy of 5 sets of needs ranging from bottom to top, also from basic to complex. Maslow's theory maintains that a person does not feel a higher need until the needs at the current level have been satisfied, and the person advances to the next level of hierarchy only when the lower level is satisfied. So this is an assumption. These are all actually the assumptions which have been taken in the Maslow's theory. Now we would see these 5 sets of needs. Let us see in the form of a diagram. This is the pyramid which Maslow had given. The basic foundation is physiological need, safety need, social need, esteem need, and self-actualization need. These are the 5 sets of needs, and as per Maslow, one need should be satisfied fully, and then the person is going to shift on to the next need. We will do all these needs one by one, and then we would take upon the organizational examples pertaining to these needs. Firstly, physiological needs. Physiological needs, as per Maslow, are the basic needs, that is hunger, thirst, shelter, clothes, etc. These should be satisfied because these are the basic sustainable which makes the existence of a person. So that is important, and the basic form of needs are these. After a person satisfies these physiological needs, we would then move on to the next higher level need, and that is safety needs. These needs are security and protection from physical and emotional harm, freedom from anxiety, stability, and a structured environment. So safety needs, what a person needs to have a feeling of security on his job, and a structured and well designed environment should be there. Again, if a person satisfies the safety needs, he would move on to satisfy the next higher level need, and that is social needs. These needs encompasses affection, belongingness, acceptance, and friendship. Then we have the esteem needs, that is feeling of self-worth and self-confidence. Here a person would ask for more status in the society. He would want more challenging tasks at job in order to achieve his esteem needs. And then is the highest level or self-actualization need, which is the last need in the hierarchy given by Maslow's pyramid. And that is need to develop fully and to realize one's capacities to the fullest extent possible. So here the person would strive for fulfilling or to working up to his fullest potential. And he would go in for a step ahead into social cause, doing good for people, at the same time achieving the organizational goals. Now let us take the organizational examples here. Firstly, physiological need, saying in an organization, if an employee is working, the physiological need would comprise of basic salary. Safety need is the needs pertaining to pension plan, grievance system, that is if he has any complaints or any issues in the organization, there should be a well-derived plan in the organization where he can go and satisfy this need. Then a social need, that is he needs to have friends in the work group. No man would work in an isolation. So he needs people around him. So even in organization, he needs of people to work with, to interact with. That is the social media. SEO is pertaining to his job title, that is what title he has been designated with. And lastly, self-actualization need is challenging job which poses a challenge for him, and he has this confidence in him that he would be able to fulfill it, and he's able to take that risk. So that is the self-actualization need here. Now these are the five sets of needs by Maslow, but there are certain criticisms in this theory. Firstly, although the theory is very renowned theory and is being still quoted whenever we go in for studies of motivation, but again, it had certain criticisms by other researchers, and the first one was there is no strict hierarchy. Other researchers, they believe that you cannot build a hierarchy in this way. It's not necessary that a person would first satisfy a lower level need, that is the basic need, and then move on to the second level need. They show that the need hierarchy does not generalize very well to countries with different cultures. So again, another criticism, that this hierarchy would not be applicable on different countries because all the countries do have their own sets of cultures. For instance, Greece and Japan, the security needs motivate them. Now physiological needs and safety needs are fine, but then the first thing what they need is more of security for people, so in jobs. So this is the first need which they would place in their hierarchy if asked for. If we take example of Sweden and Norway, they believe that belongingness needs is their priority over physiological needs. So you cannot actually generalize a strict hierarchy on all the nations. The third criticism was a person tries for his higher level need when his lower order need is reasonably satisfied. Now this term reasonably satisfied is what is taken on by the researchers. They believe that, as Maslow said, that only when one need is satisfied, the person then is going to move to a higher level need. But here, this is the diagram which explains this criticism. Here you see that the person, if you look here, the first need starts from here, physiological need, and before this need is satisfied fully, the another set of need starts here and cuts here. So the another set of need has already begun. Before the first set of need could satisfy, the another need has already started. So it is reasonable satisfaction of one of the needs and not to the fullest extent possible. So it ruled out one of the assumptions of Maslow's theory. But anyhow, this theory still is being studied, and it gives you a sense of a true meaning of term motivation and why exactly people get motivated in the organizations. So if you talk about the applicability, till date managers do apply this theory and try to find out the needs of employees and then motivate them. The second set of theory is Clayton Enderfer's ERG theory. Now this theory is actually little bit a development over need based theory or need hierarchy theory of Maslow, because here you can see that the same five sets of needs as given by Maslow have been clubbed again into three, because Enderfer believed that there is a very small line of demarcation between certain needs, and so they can be clubbed together. And if you can see here, the ERG theory actually reduces the five needs into three sets of needs, which are existence needs, relatedness, and growth needs. Now, what are these needs, and why they have been clubbed? The first is existence needs. They include all needs related to physiological and safety aspects of an individual. Thus, existence needs group physiological and safety needs of Maslow into one category, as these have similar impact on the behavior of an individual. So, the two sets of needs which have been clubbed here are the physiological and the safety needs of Maslow. The second is relatedness needs. It includes all those needs that involve relationship with other people whom the individual cares. Relatedness needs cover Maslow's social needs and that part of esteem needs which is derived from the relationship with other people. So actually we call it as external esteem needs, which are a part of this relatedness needs. So basically here we have social need plus the external esteem needs, which are derived out from people around you, you gain that status. That is the relatedness needs. The growth needs. Growth needs involve the individual making creative efforts to achieve full potential in the existing environment. And these include Maslow's self-actualization need as well as that part of the esteem need, which is internal to the individual, like feeling of being unique, feeling of personal growth, etc. So here we actually talk about the Maslow's fifth need and a part of the esteem need. The part of esteem need which is covered here is internal esteem need, which is, you know, the feelings of an individual which are within him and which would motivate him to perform. So this is feeling of being unique, feeling of personal growth. All these are the internal esteem needs plus self-actualization needs. Both of them, they form the growth needs. Now this was Ellerfer's theory, which was just a little bit development over the Maslow's theory. Certainly it had its own criticism. And it also said that frustration to satisfy higher level need can result in regression to lower level need. So its frustration regression component, this theory also emphasized or actually criticized one of the points which were given in the Maslow's theory, is that a person cannot follow a strict hierarchy. And so if it follows one set of need, if it is, you know, if one set of need is unsatisfied, so it can also lead into regression to a lower level need. The person can come down and fulfill his basic need again and then might again try for a higher level need. So the regression term was coined first time by Plato and Ellerfer, which meant that a people can move into a lower set of need if the higher set of need is not satisfied. So these were the two sets of motivation theories, which we also call them as need-based theories. The third theory is Frederick Herzberg's motivation hygiene theory, which was developed in 1950s. It is also known as two-factor theory. Now this theory, it was developed by Frederick Herzberg and his associates. And they started with an interview with 200 engineers and accountants in Pittsburgh area to study job satisfaction. They interviewed these people, and because the researchers felt that the person's attitude towards the work determines organizational related behavior. And so the respondents were asked to answer on two questions. The first one was, which is the environment in which they felt good in working, and which is the environment in which they felt uncomfortable in their work? These were the two sets of questions which were being asked. And whatever responses were gathered, they were actually divided into two sets of factors. One set of factors which are linked to job satisfaction, and another set of factors which are linked to job dissatisfaction. So Herzberg named these factors that tend to be related to job satisfaction as motivational factors, and factors related to job dissatisfaction as hygiene factors. Now, what are these two factors? The first one, motivational factors, are those factors which are directly linked to job satisfaction. Means the presence of these factors would lead to job satisfaction. Another is hygiene factors, which actually means that the presence of these factors might not lead to job satisfaction, but their absence would certainly lead to job dissatisfaction. That is the idea behind hygiene factors. Now, which are these factors? As per the responses collected, they categorized all the responses into these two factors. You can see here, motivators. They relate to the nature of the work itself. That is, autonomy. That an employee should be given power to take decisions. That acts as a motivator. That would certainly give him job satisfaction. Responsibility, that is giving him a task, at the same time an authority to take a decision on it, for which he will be accountable for. There is interesting work. The work should be very challenging and should pertain to the interest area of the person, and this certainly acts as a motivator and would lead to job satisfaction. Achievement. When we talk about achievement, it is what a person has accomplished. So, if the accomplishment is good, it acts as a motivator of a person. And lastly, advancement, that is how far a person is progressing in the organization, which is directly related to his job satisfaction. Hygiene needs are related to the physical and psychological context of the work. That is comfortable work environment, pay. The work environment should be really good, very comfortable. A person should have all resources to work with. Because these hygiene needs, they are, by the term itself, we can say hygiene is derived from a medical term, which means a person has to have, say for instance, you wash your hands. So it is to maintain our basic hygiene. We do not want to get ill. It's a prevention from getting ill. But it is not a cure for any form of disease. So hygiene, in a similar way, are the factors which actually would not lead to job satisfaction, but the absence of which would certainly give job dissatisfaction to people. So if the people lack resources such as basic structure, basic place of doing work, their own space, comfortable work environment, say the place of work is very suffocated, or there is no ventilation, the basic things are not there, drinking water is not there, these act as dissatisfiers. Pay is a very important factor. If a person is actually not getting a fair pay, then he might be dissatisfied with his job. Job security, company policies should be very much people favorable, and which are going to actually give him, to some extent, would not lead to dissatisfaction. Administration, that is, if in case a person has complaints or he has any small request, there should be a clear laid down authority systems in the organization, a person to whom he can report to. Supervision and salary, which is quite again the same pay. So these are all sets of factors which we gathered out of the research done by Herzberg and his associates and were categorized as hygiene factors. So unsatisfied hygiene needs create dissatisfaction, and satisfaction of hygiene needs does not lead to motivation or job satisfaction. So this is another theory which actually explains the relation of need of person, what can be satisfied to motivate a person. The next set of theory is McGregor's theory X and theory Y. This is again a theory which actually explains two sets of people in the organization. That people who follow theory X and people who fall in the category of theory Y. So he has tried to explain these two types of people who are working in the organization and how these two people can be motivated. How theory X people can be motivated and how theory Y people can be motivated. So here, when we talk about theory X people, there are certain assumptions. If we talk about theory X, first let us talk about the shape of this theory X. Why it is termed as theory X? If you look at here, these are individual goals and these are organizational goals in these two directions. So here, individual goals, you can see there is no alignment between both of them. Individual goals are separate from the organizational goals, and that is why it has derived this type of shape, and this is theory X. Now if we jump into theory Y, why this is Y is because here, if you see here, there is an alignment here, over here. This is individual goal and organizational goal. When these two goals, they meet down here, this is the alignment here. So here we say individual goals get aligned with organizational goals. So that is why there is a difference in the characteristics of these two sets of people who lie under theory X and who lie under theory Y. Now these sets of people, they have their own assumptions. Under theory X, it is assumed that employees inherently dislike work and whenever possible will attempt to avoid it. And employees will avoid their responsibilities and seek formal direction whenever possible. Now these sets of people who lie under theory X would need a special, you know, a type of different type of leadership style. And that would mean close supervision, control of subordinates, and autocratic leadership. So close supervision is, we can also call it as micromanagement, because here since people would be working only out of punishment or by close control, and then they would work because they have an inherent dislike for work. And autocratic leadership means that there would be flow of communication only in one direction, in the form of commands, orders, instructions, and the workers would have no say in decision making. And that is because of their own characteristics of theory X. So these are the assumptions in theory X. Next we have theory Y. We can see here, these sets of employees, they view work as natural, as rest or play. People will exercise self-direction and self-control if they are committed to the objectives. So here the employees are actually, you know, very, they enjoy the work, they feel it's their pleasure working, you know, they're very happy doing this work. They exercise self-direction, they are already motivated employees, because you can see by the diagram of Y, there is an alignment in between the organizational goal and individual goal. And so they have this self-direction in them, that is they are quite themselves very much aroused by the fact that what goals they have to achieve. Self-control is, they know how much they have to work, they know how far they have to meet their deadlines in time. So these are a set of people who are very much committed and who always exercise self-control and self-direction. So the type of leadership required for these theory why is decentralization of authority, because the leader having such set of people, like theory why people, might pass on his power to them so that they can take decisions, because again he himself has full confidence over these employees. Then job enrichment. That means higher sets of responsibilities could be given to these sets of employees, which may be accompanied with an enhanced pay structure, maybe linked to any financial rewards. And leadership style would comprise of two-way communication. That is, some suggestions from the employees and acceptance of the suggestions by the leader, then he would go in for taking the decision. So these are the certain assumptions of theory why, and the type of leadership or type of what a manager can do to motivate such type of people. It can be explained with the help of this chart here, the difference between theory X and theory Y. So here you can see theory X has close supervision, there is control of subordinates, high centralization of authority, and there is no say in decision making. So these are actually how a manager will have to behave if he has theory X type of people under him. Theory Y, if we talk of, you can see here the leadership style would be decentralization of authority, job enrichment, participative leadership, that is the leader would always seek guidance and suggestion from his subordinates. He would always encourage them to participate in decision making, and then only the final decision would be arrived at. And obviously two-way communication system. Now the last set of theory, content theory or need-based theory of motivation, is McClellan's needs theory. Now this theory has identified three types of basic motivating needs. He classified these as need for power, need for affiliation, and need for achievement. He has identified these three needs, and he says that an employee would be motivated in an organization if he has either of these needs. And once, in order to fulfill these needs, he would be motivated to perform better in the organization. But as for him, need for achievement is what is found up to a higher level in the organizational members, which acts as the basic or the general need. So let us discuss all these needs one by one. The first is need for power. Power as a term itself, we can say, is something which influences behavior, is power. McClellan and his associates have found that people with a high power need have a great concern for exercising influence and control. Such individuals generally seek positions of leadership. They involve conversation. They are forceful, outspoken, hard-headed, and demanding. So these are few characteristics of people having this power motive or power need. The second is affiliation motive. That is quite similar to need for people around, need for groups around. So the explanation says that since people are social animals, most individuals like to interact and be with others in situations where they feel they belong and are accepted. They're concerned in maintaining pleasant social relationship, enjoying a sense of intimacy and understanding, and enjoy consoling and helping others in trouble. That is affiliation motive. So this is more of people entering into good relationships with the organization, trying to help each other, and if for satisfying this type of need, they would be motivated. The third and the final set of need here, as given by McLelland's theory, is need for achievement. This is also said as an act. So here, behavioral scientists have observed that some people have an intense desire to achieve. McLelland's research has led him to believe that the need for achievement is a distinct human motive that can be distinguished from other needs. It can also be isolated and assessed in any group. So this need is actually what McLelland says is the most important set of need, and which actually distinguishes itself from other sets of needs here. So these needs are there. Now looking into the most important need, that is need for achievement, McLelland has also identified four basic characteristics which these employees with high achievement motive would have. The first is, these sets of people would always go in for moderate risk. That is, they would not take very high risk, or they would not go in for very low type of jobs, low risk jobs, which would be very easy for them to achieve. So somewhat bit of challenging, but moderate risk. Then such people also strive for immediate feedback. Whatever work they have done, they want immediate reaction to it, immediate feedback from their superiors, that how the work is done. If they feel that the superior is not that satisfied, then they might ask for some improvements into this type of work. Accomplishment is, they feel happy. People with high achievement need, they feel happy if they fulfill a task in a given time. So they have this sense of accomplishment in them. Lastly, the fourth characteristic of these high achievers are, they are very much preoccupied with the task. They would never sit idle. They always keep on doing some work, some task, and they would never sit back without work. So these are the four sets of traits or characteristics of high achievers. This completes our set of all content theories or need-based theories of motivation, which actually explains the term motivation from need-based or need-incentive-based angle. That is, a person would be motivated if he has certain sets of needs, and then he would perform better in the organization. Thank you.